in every temptation, said, away with you, Satan. So he renounced Satan. And we know that there's great power in Jesus' name. So renouncing the evil one, or renouncing that temptation to whatever it may be, in the name of Jesus, it's our way of taking the authority that Jesus gives us over that sin or that temptation or over the evil one. And then, you know, the third thing that Jesus did was, he replaced the lie with the truth. So he quoted from the scriptures. If it's about not feeling like I have enough energy or I can't do this, then, you know, I'll replace that lie with the truth. You know, the Lord is my shepherd, there's nothing I shall want, or I have strength for everything through him who empowers me, who strengthens me. I like what the Catechism again says. It says, Jesus' victory over the tempter in the desert anticipates victory at the Passion. That what Jesus does here is ultimately going to do for us on the cross. I like what it says in John 10:10. It says that the evil one is to come to kill, to steal, and destroy. It's that clear. The purpose, the desire, the goal of the evil one is the destruction of you, the destruction of me. We need to become more aware that there's a battle that's taking place. And it's a battle between the kingdoms of darkness and the kingdom of light. And the prize is you. The prize is your soul. The prize is my soul. But we need to understand, as we hear in the scriptures, that Jesus is victorious, that the evil one is not going to defeat him, but Jesus will ultimately be the victor. And we need to be able to claim that.
I really believe that the evil one, the devil, wants to destroy our lives. I really believe he wants to destroy our faith, destroy our marriages, but he does it in very subtle ways. And I find that I have to say to myself when I'm getting, and I'll get thoughts, and I'll say, is that the way? And this is what helps me the most. I say, is that the way God would speak to me? Is that the way Jesus would speak to me? Is that the way the Holy Spirit will speak to me? And I'll use the words that Jesus said to Peter. He wasn't necessarily telling Peter this, but get behind me, Satan. And I say, I bind you and cast you out in the name of Jesus. I believe in the power of prayer is the best weapon against the evil one, and not be afraid to cast him out in Jesus' name.
Goes on to say, and again in John's gospel in the 8th chapter, it says that the father of lies, there is no truth in him. And I think it's important that we understand that that's one of the main ways the evil one gets to us, is he lies to us. What are these lies that we hear that just continually go through our mind? And sometimes we've heard them for so long, we don't even recognize that they're lies, that the lie that says you're not enough, you have no value, you have no worth, you're not as good as, the lie that says it's your fault, the lie that says you can never be forgiven, the lie that says God will never forget. I mean, what is that lie that continually consumes you? That is the evil one, the father of lies. We need to become more aware of it. In many ways, having a conversion, that we recognize this battle that's taking place in us.
The enemy love, like, works in lies. And when I look at the young people that I've worked with, the ministry that I've done, there's kind of two lies that seem to be permeating with everybody. One, that they are alone. And that's a powerful lie when you get someone to believe that, because when you're alone, then we tend to do frantic things, things out of character, in order to get some sort of consolation, some sort of like friendship. And we see the way that, like, some young people act, and you wonder, why are you doing that? Because that makes no sense at all. It's because they don't want to be alone. You can be moral, or you can have friends. And for most of us, we will choose having friends, having companions, over being moral. So being alone, that's one lie I feel that the enemy tries to get somebody into. And the second one is that you're unlovable. You're alone and that you're unlovable. Because if you believe that you're unlovable, it'll make you we tend to treat people out of the way that we feel about ourselves. And if we believe that we're unlovable, then it's easy for me, if I don't see any worth in myself, to treat another person the same way, to treat them as if they're worthless. It's easy for me, if I believe that I'm unlovable, to stay in that place of being alone. And when we're alone, then the enemy can just whisper into our ears. And any words of affirmation that we may tend to hear, we'll figure a way to not believe those words of affirmation because we believe the lie that we're unlovable and alone.
I love in Mark's gospel, Jesus is in the synagogue in Capernaum, which we were able to visit. And the scripture says that in the synagogue was a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God." It's interesting that the evil one, all right, we may not always know, but the evil one knew exactly who Jesus was. Jesus rebukes him and says, "Quiet, come out of him." The unclean spirit convulsed in him and with a loud cry came out of him. All were amazed and asked one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority." This is interesting. There are lots of people in Jesus's time who were doing battle with the evil one and trying to cast out demons, but they had these rituals that they would do. They were long, and they had these little trinkets that they would shake over the people, and they would dance and all of these magical spells and stuff to try to break the power of the evil one. Jesus is quite different. Jesus speaks a word, and the evil one obeys him. Jesus has a power and authority in him and who he was. And when Jesus spoke, the evil one shrieked and went out of him. And we need to be able to claim that.
I was reading the Song of Songs, and there's a verse that says, "You're as lovely as Jerusalem, as awe-inspiring as bannered troops." And this just painted this interesting image in my mind of seeing this army in full battle array. And that's how the Lord sees his beloved, is this army in full battle array. And I just heard the Lord say, "The devil fears you." And I said, "What are you saying? Are you saying that this raging beast is afraid of a little flower?" And I realized that was exactly what he was saying. But later the Lord would show me that you're afraid of one who is afraid, because the power in me is greater than the power that is in the world. You know, resist the devil and he will flee from you. We don't realize how terrified the devil is of the Lord, and the Lord is in us. And so we get so frightened over someone who's actually quite frightened, and we don't realize this power that's in us.
I love the text in Luke's gospel. It's the 10th chapter of Luke. It says, "The 72 returned rejoicing and said, 'Lord, even the demons are subject to us because of your name.' Jesus said, 'I have observed Satan fall like lightning from the sky. Behold, I have given you the power to tread upon serpents and scorpions and upon the full force of the enemy, and nothing will harm you.'" That this is so powerful, that Jesus gave them power and authority, and he's given us power and authority. We need to realize and come to understand that the power we have over the evil one is because of Jesus. One time when I was really young in the faith, I was praying with this person, and it was kind of obvious that there was something going on with him and maybe some presence of evil in him. And I remember, again, being young and brash and not really understanding everything, I just said, you know, to the evil one, I said, "I'm just not afraid of you. Just leave him alone." And at that moment, there was just this power of fear that came over me. As soon as I said, "I'm not afraid of you," speaking to the evil one, what I understand now that I didn't understand there is that it's not in my power. It's not in my strength. It's not in my grace, but it's in the grace and the power in the name of Jesus. Our catechism actually says this. It says that we have power at baptism, that we are freed from the power of the evil one. That it's not anything that I've done, but it's what Christ has done that gives me power. And we need to be able to claim that and understand the profound change that takes place in baptism, that because I am baptized, I am in Christ. It's not just a little bit of Christ who dwells in me, that I dwell in Christ. And because of that, I have power, I have authority. And this isn't just some ethereal thing, it's this theology, but it's a lived experience that when we are tempted, when we're having struggles, we need to be able to claim that. When something is going on, I can claim that power that the Lord has given to us. Catechism also says that every time we pray the Our Father, we're saying, "Deliver us from the evil one." That there is power in the word of God. There is power and grace in what Jesus has given to us. And we need to be able to claim that. We don't need to be obsessed with the evil one. We don't need to be afraid. We just need to be aware. We need to be cognizant of the evil one. Now, there are a couple of ways that the evil one tries to get to us. And it's traditional, right? The world, the flesh, and the devil. The Catechism, speaking about St. John, it says, the consequences of original sin and of man's personal sin put the world as a whole in a sinful condition, aptly described in St. John's expression, the sin of the world. The sin of the world, structures, powers, media, systems that are opposed to the kingdom of God. And again, that there is a battle that takes place, and the evil one is going to use all of those structures to try to bring about our destruction. But it's not just the world, it's also the flesh. St. Paul often talks about this battle that's taking place between the spirit of the flesh and the spirit of God. And the more we're aware of this battle that's taking place within each one of us, and it often lives itself out in the sins of the passion, right? We want more. We go to the buffet line and we eat 10 times more than we probably should. And this desire to accumulate and to get, and the passions of lust, the passions of wealth, all of these passions, that's what Paul is talking about, the sins of the flesh. And I think this is the sin of the flesh that takes place in each one of us. It's easy for us to, the devil made me do it. But that there is some battle within the flesh. That's what Paul talks about and the saints talk about so often. I think the monks who come to this church here pray about this battle that's taking place.
It's really important to understand that spiritual warfare or spiritual battle is not an analogy. As Paul uses like running a race, or people might use like climbing a mountain as an analogy for the Christian life, but that's not what spiritual warfare is. Spiritual warfare is a reality. This isn't just like a story fairy tale that we're using to express our faith. This is a reality, and that he's hell-bent literally on bringing us away from God. And so our response has to be serious. It needs to be deliberate, and it needs to not give him too much credence, but also know that we have an enemy, right? Scripture says, be sober and watchful, for your enemy roams around the earth like a prowling lion looking for someone to devour. That's a serious, sobering statement. And we have to take it seriously, at the same time understanding that it's a creature. The devil is a creature. God is all powerful, totally. And that a victory was won completely and totally on the cross. And that victory was given to the church and should be realized in our life.
The reality of the devil is real. I mean, he really exists. And sometimes when I see myself being threatened, you know, with bad thoughts or doing something wrong, I know it's the devil trying to get at me. And that's when I have this great feeling I can appeal to the Holy Spirit. You come on, Holy Spirit, come to me. Put some armor on me and keep that. I'm going to use some bad words. Keep him away from me. The devil is real.
And again, this is not just pie in the sky, but it's at the moment. The next time you're with your children and they've done something that's wrong, or you're with a spouse or somebody in work and you find yourself getting frustrated and angry, that is a moment. That moment right there is a moment of grace. That's a moment of metanoia, of conversion, that I can give in to the sinfulness of the flesh or the evil one, the way he wants me to lash out or say something that I'm ultimately going to regret, take a piece of cake when I probably shouldn't. Ultimately, I'm going to regret. At that moment, there is grace available. This isn't just an idea. There is grace available for us to receive and experience power of the evil one. And then the final one is the evil one. So the world, the flesh, and the devil, the evil one in his dominions trying to defeat and trying to kill us. The best way for us to have protection and power over the evil one is obviously to be in Christ. And if we're being tempted to just say, you know, in the name of Jesus, I'm just not going to give in to that. But also actually to live, it's self-evident, but to live a moral life. That to the degree that I'm living a moral life and I'm living a life of virtue, it doesn't, if you will, open doors for the evil one to come to us. So, you know, if you're looking at pornography, or if you're not being faithful, or you're giving in to the spirit of lust or gluttony or gossip or lying or whatever it is, that we open up doors that allow the evil one to get to us. We need to be able to close those doors so that the evil one doesn't have the power to get to us. What's important for us, though, and I can't stress this enough, is that we ought not be afraid, but the Lord has given us power, he's given us grace, he's given us victory. And we find that victory most clearly in the resurrection of Jesus.
The opposition is satanic, first of all, because back in chapter 4, at the conclusion of the temptation narrative, Luke says that Satan departed, awaiting a more opportune time. Satan disappears from the narrative entirely from that point. His underlings, the minions, the demons appear from time to time in exorcism stories, but not Satan. He returns at the top of 21, which is the beginning of the Passion narrative. So now you know that the entire Passion from Luke's point of view is the closure of that battle that started in the desert. It's happening in Jerusalem here precisely because of Old Testament prophecy, importantly, the prophecy about the Mount of Olives. That's where the satanic battle comes to its climax. And Jesus wins, in a sense, by looking like he's lost.
The greatest victory of the evil one was death. The loss, the separation, the pain, the suffering, the finality of it all. Imagine the evil one was dancing as Jesus's body was taken off the cross and was laid on a cold stone. The evil one thought the victory had been won. And then early in the morning, Mary Magdala, who was suffering the loss of Jesus, Jesus whom she loved, Scripture says, gets up early in the morning as the sun is rising, walking through the streets of Jerusalem, walking ultimately to a cemetery. She just wants to be close to him. She just wants to be able to sit next to the tomb where Jesus was. And yet we know the story that she comes and she arrives to the tomb and the tomb is empty.
You just want to scream, like almost scream like that. Your anthem is like, the tomb is empty, right? None of this matters, you know, whatever it is, none of this matters. And I think like, we know that we're fulfilled in having a relationship with God right now, and we're so joyful, but we're so happy because we get to spend our eternity with him.
The resurrection is the final victory, the final power over the evil one, over death. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? That in Jesus's resurrection, that all will rise. It's not merely Jesus that broke the power of the evil one, but Jesus broke the power of the evil one for all baptized Christians. That when Jesus arises, those who are in Christ will also arise with him. The resurrection of Jesus is the final victory for each one of us. That as we run the race well, as we do our best to love the Lord, to serve, to honor him, to love one another, one day we too will arise with Jesus. The evil one will have no more power over us. We claim the victory that has been given to us in Jesus. Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? Let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, your power and your grace continues to be poured forth in us. Lord Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit would come upon us and that you would fill us with your grace and your power. That by your anointing, the evil one has no more power, has no more authority over us. Jesus, we pray that by your grace, that we're able to recognize how the evil one tries to tempt us, how he tries to lead us away, but by your power, we have victory. Jesus, come with your Holy Spirit. We are more than victors. We make this prayer in your name, Jesus, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Well, welcome all those who joined us while we were apart. Let's see, we're not seeing everybody. I guess we are. Hi. Well, what do you think? How did that strike you? What's your first thoughts?
You know, I think mine are, I'm never real comfortable talking about the evil one, or when someone talks about the devil or Satan, or, you know, I don't like it when it's read in the Gospels. I don't like it yet, you know, hearing Father Dave talk about it. It is very real, and, you know, we have to be cognizant. You know, the devil, yeah, the devil's in the world, the devil's in the United States, and the devil in our country, and the devil is tempting me. I just, you know, and I can think about it, how it happens, but for some reason, I've never been real comfortable with it.
Yeah, that's, I think that's what a lot of us, thank you for sharing so honestly. I think often we're afraid even to kind of acknowledge the presence, let it overwhelm us. But I thought the words of Sister, you know, I told you to kind of listen to them when she said the beast is afraid of the little flower. I thought, oh, how true is that? We, and that the power of baptism in us, it doesn't even have to be, it only has to be a mustard seed. And I loved what Dave said about that God is omnipotent, God is God, and this is a creature. They aren't the same, they're not equal. And why do we sometimes think the devil is as powerful as God? Like what seduces us into those thoughts? Anybody have any responses to any of that, all that?
I think it's the idea of the black and white, or the, you know, the yin and yang, whatever you want to call it. I think so many of us think good and evil, that they're equal and counterparts. And maybe that's what it is. We tend to put things on scales. And like you said, it's not, we know how this one ends. Mm-hmm. And we know that it's a happy ending. And we know who's victorious. I love that he just kept saying that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's amazing how there's even a seduction in the sense that we think the creature is stronger than the creature is. I think I'm going to put into print somewhere, the beast is afraid of the flower. I don't know why that imagery just blew me away, but I look for it. And this is the fourth time I've watched this. I'd wait for her to say that, because she always reminds me, she's so diminutive, and she seems to be this little prayer powerhouse. And I kept thinking about how armed she is by her prayer, and how she's telling us. And we hear Dr. Minto talk about that too, when the final joke is really on the evil one, thinking he had overcome Christ, but the joke was on him, that the victory was not. And then, you know, we hear from Paul, death, where is your victory? Where is your sting? So and like I said, that figure about Jesus approaching demons 25 times in the scriptures, I don't know why I never, like, not bothered to count, but kind of collectively think about that. How do I, in some ways, not brush it off, but maybe think that was then, this is now, and not realizing that it's this, well, I think I do realize it, but I don't want to realize it. I don't know if it's afraid of it, but I don't like taking it in, because almost if I take it in, I give it power, if that makes any sense. Yeah, I'm gonna talk a little bit about spiritual warfare. We heard a little bit about, Dave was talking a little bit about it, and I'm hoping Amy gets to a place where she can talk, because she has some good things to say about this. But I have noticed in my own life, and I've noticed that I have a very good friend. I've mentioned him before. He was the Bishop of Papua New Guinea, but he wasn't always the bishop. He was just the local assistant priest way back when. And he would often tell me that, Tina, that whenever I was about to make, you know, my solemn profession, when I was, you know, about to be ordained, when I was going to be whatever it was, there was something that happened that was, in a sense, a battle for him, because knowing that he would give his life to God and give his life to God and bring other people closer to God, he felt that there was always some sort of battle or some kind of discord. And if we remember that Satan is a sower of chaos, so when we're in a chaotic time, it may not be like what I would say blatant evil, but it's discord, it's confusion, it's questioning, just like Bishop Christian spoke about how we sometimes then have self-doubt and we don't recognize our gifts, and we get overcome with those feelings of, am I good enough? Am I going to say the right thing? Am I going to, and how all of those esteem issues are the questioner, is Satan throwing them at them. Did that resonate with anyone, or did that like strike a nerve? Everyone's nodding their head. Because where does those thoughts come from in our heads? Sally?
I have found through the many years of being a Christian, like they said in the video, the thing that works the fastest and the best for me are the powerful words, in the name of Jesus, Satan, be gone. And he is. It's gone like that. I had a dream the other night, and I get a lot of crazy dreams. But in the dream, this creature was coming after me. He had snow white curls, gleaming eyes, and he was going, and I, even in my dream, said, in the name of Jesus, Satan, be gone. He was gone. So those words are powerful. And I recommend them to everyone because they work.
Amy and I often, when we are finding that we come up on obstacles or things just don't seem to be working out, we kind of share with one another that that there are moments when I know we're about to do something good, Amy. And that's what I'll say, Amy, we're about to do something good. Something good is going to happen. God is going to work through this. And we just have to say, in a sense, Satan be gone. And then we have to kind of laugh at it. I love the image of God just laughing at like the efforts of Satan, thinking, and with Satan thinking he was going to be superior. That's like a beautiful image I have in my head. And I don't know where it came from. I actually think it did come from either the screw tape letters or somewhere, but I have this image of just a ha ha ha, ha. You know, I just love that. So thanks, Sally, for that. We strongly urge everyone to put them in that, those words in a place that you could look to if you're feeling that chaos moment, that moment of discord, that moment when you feel like there's a lot of doubt, and then just this sense that Jesus, I put my trust in you, and Satan be gone. You have no power over me. I want to, does anyone have anything to add that, or any experience that they may have had?
I wanted to say something, Tina. I think I really liked when Father Dave said that those same moments where you're saying Satan be gone, that moment, or when you say something good is about to happen, he said that's a moment of grace. And I think when you are aware, I think it's the awareness, and maybe that's where the be vigilant comes from, the awareness that, hey, I can go either way here. And I think that's the part. If I could share a real quick story, I've been struggling with some pretty major personal stuff, as everyone has this year. And last week's, the idea of being bound up by, and in the tomb and then letting those things go really just was a very good visualization for me. So I was 2 weeks out from my vaccination, and it was the first time I got to go. The first place I was going to go was Mass. And I thought, I'm going to go get Eucharist for the first time since March. And I was so excited. Sorry, my dog's barking. I was so excited to do that. And of course I couldn't, because I had to take my dad to a doctor's appointment. And I'm like, okay, that's okay. That's what I have to do. And I'll go on Tuesday. So I went to St. Thomas on Tuesday. The Mass starts at 8:00. It was over at 8:28. I got 2 phone calls from my parents in that time that my dad needed to go back out to the doctor. Well, when I looked and hurried up and saw that it was him calling again, I put in, that was my chance at grace. I was like, I didn't know if I should run out. Should I stay? Should I ignore him? And I tried the Jesus, I trust in you, take care of everything. But of course I added the just for the next 20 minutes so I can get communion. And it turned out to be fine. But I thought, wow, that was just, that was that moment of, you know, the two roads, which way am I going to go? And I think it's the awareness. I think I'm very aware, and I've always been aware of, I don't want to say of the devil, but I've been aware of evil because I see, and I've seen kids, so many kids feel unloved. They truly think they are unlovable. And all the bad behaviors that I see in a classroom comes from most of the time that they feel either alone or unloved. And if you see that in kids, I think it's the same with adults too. So that's all I wanted to share.
No, thank you for sharing that. It is amazing. The one, how they said that the gentleman who works with young people, and he spoke about how sometimes people, if they're feeling that way, they treat other people that way. And I thought that is giving me a lot of food for thought. And it makes me think of then if I see that happening, how I need to pray for that person too, rather than pass judgment on the way they're, you know, like I should pass judgment, but I, you know, we all do that. But rather pray because that person does not fully know who they are in the eyes of God. And it's so important that we begin to know that. I want to share, Amy, I'm going to share your precious little find right now that, Father, if any of you have been doing the consecration of St. Joseph or have done it in the past with Father Donald Calloway, this is a talk that he did on Mary. And it's important for us to understand that all, of course, we have the power of Jesus and we have the power of the Holy Trinity within us. That was given to us through our baptism. And we're going to talk about that power a little later on. But it's important to remember that Jesus also gave us human models and human accompaniments, and that in that community of saints that we've talked about before, how this is our network, these are our people, that we have to sort of think about them and maybe really take in their the strength of their faith, the witness of their love, and their witness of their fidelity to God, and then what that does for us in the moments that we are weak. We had talked about things like spiritual communion and how someone can take it on someone else's behalf. We have to remember that that is also true in moments of our own trial or moments of when we are under the discord and in the chaos of, you know, of the evil one who's come after us. So I'm going to share my screen again. And here we go.
So I want you right now to imagine with me, because we're going to talk about the Virgin Mary, the masterpiece of God. I want you to imagine right now that you're God. Congratulations. Right? You just got, you're omnipotent. You're all powerful. You're omniscient. You're all knowing. You're God. You're the real deal, okay? You created this world and given them free will and all of its beautiful places, but they jacked it up, right? And they made a mess of it. You know how the story goes. You are so good. You didn't just wind up the clock and send it off. You know, that's not the God we're talking about. That's craziness. You're so good that you're going to enter into the world, the world that you made that's fallen, and become one of them. How are you going to do that? Rub-a-dub-dub, Shazam, poof. Out of the heavens you appear as a 33-year-old Messiah ready to accomplish my saving mission. Father God, hoo-yah, right now. That's magic. You made an anthropological order. You set things up in a system of laws. You're going to abide by that. You're not going to break it. So you're going to come into the world. Now, one of you, only one of you, the triune God, is going to come in. So let's just say right now that you're the Word and you're going to enter into the world. Hey, what are you going to do? What's that mean? Well, we know what it means. You are going to make your own mom. Yeah. Okay? That's like a no-brainer, but somehow we miss that. Jesus made his own mother. Never has it been heard that a child, a son, precedes his mother, right? I didn't come before my mom, neither did you. We came after. That's just how it works. But in this instance, God made his own mom. Whoa, what does that mean? It means a lot. I'm going to put myself in this little experiment with you, and I'm going to act like I'm God. I'm not, trust me. Hang out with me long enough, you'll be like, ooh, pray for Father, you know. I'm far from being divine, you don't know. But for the sake of argument, what would I do if I were God and had all power, all knowledge, all ability to make my own mother? Oh, I would make her a masterpiece. I would make a flawless model of maternity, of femininity. So amazingly beautiful, there would be no other creature like her. I would do this for my mom because I had the power to do it. You know, if I had this enemy called Satan, Lucifer, the devil, and I was going to make my own mother, why would I, if I were God, leave any kind of stain in her? Why would I do that? You know what I would do? Let me think of a word. What would I create my mother? Oh, yeah. Immaculate, flawless, absolutely, ravishingly beautiful on every level is what I would do. It would make my enemy so mad because he would probably hope that I would, you know, maybe come into the world through a creature, but she'd still be a sinner. Oh no, not my mother. Because I'm making my own mom. Flawless, immaculate, perfect. As a matter of fact, you know what I would do? I would write a book as God, a big one. I'd call the first chapter, I don't know, Genesis. I call the last one Revelation, like apocalyptic stuff, dragons and stuff. And in that book, you know what I talk about? I would talk about my mom's delicate little female foot crushing Satan's ugly face. I'd do that. I really would. If I were God. Totally.
So what'd you think of that? Mm-hmm. Think about it. We, you know, the crushing of Satan's head under Mary's little diminutive foot, just kind of like that image of that, you know, that sister, the beast and the flower. It's a incredible image that that we're provided with of Mary crushing the head of Satan. And yet we act afraid, or we sometimes get swept up into it. The part that I wanted to kind of like lead into from here, do you remember when Father Dave was talking about the passions, and he was talking about, you know, I mean, he was talking about obvious things that maybe be more sexual related, lustful, but he was talking about things like wealth and the pursuit of like prestige. How did that strike you in this conversation? Have you ever saw it as like the little minions kind of like luring you away from where you're supposed to be? Or have you just never given in any thought? It's okay if you haven't given thought, because that's kind of what tends to happen. Anything strike you about those passions? I liked how he called them passions. Mm-hmm.
I feel like for myself, it's been a journey, and from immaturity to maturity. And the maturity is when there's this realization that God that is not God's plan for us to have more, to be more, to have all these things, because that is the evil one. I mean, the love of money is what's evil. Not money itself, but the love of money, you know? So anyway, I think my point is it's a maturity thing for me personally. As a young person, you know, I wanted to have this career, and I wanted to have $1 million by the time I was 30. Of course, that didn't happen. But at some point, that really decreases and the search for God increases. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Thanks, Michelle. Thank you.
We can also relate the, you know, like in the readings of St. Joseph, and how, you know, they were lovers of poverty. I mean, they were very simple, humble people. And I think it was the reading from today with the Saint Joseph. They kind of lived off of the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and they had to use that just to meet their basics. You know, Saint Joseph was just a humble carpenter. He wasn't out for any kind of prestige. You know, his goal was to serve our Lord, his son, and his beloved wife, you know, and just lived a very simple life, but yet was filled just with so much happiness, peace, tranquility, you know what I mean? Kind of just kept it very simple. And you think about it too, you know, I think sometimes the simpler we are in our lives, I think just the more happiness we find, because mm-hmm. when you're striving for wealth and everything, you're working long hours, you're obsessed with work and career, and you find very little time to really do what's meaningful, you know?
Yeah, I so agree with you, Angela, in that, because I think it might have been this Sunday's, could have been the epistle, one of the readings where, I think it was from the Acts, of course, that's what we're reading now, when the early apostles and the early Christians, and they said they, you know, everybody just put all of their possessions into one pot. So, and they shared them with the poor, shared it with the poor. And, you know, that's something that, you know, that touches me, because we're nowhere near doing that kind of thing. You know, we try, but, you know, I don't think that's tough, yeah. but it's something to think about, mm-hmm. you know, what the early Christians did.
Mm-hmm. The one of the fastest growing industries in our country, even amidst COVID, which is kind of interesting to think that it continued to advance when everything else is sort of in a like flat line or dropping, are the storage units. You know, have you noticed how many storage units there are, even just close to each of the churches, that they weren't there just 2 years ago?
Yeah.
And they're and we can't fit them in our homes.
I have noticed that. And people are cleaning a lot of things out, which is wonderful. But it at the same time, it's like, okay, what can I do with this? Where do I put it all? And that's, I think, why they are creating more of that, because it's like, there's just, people are finding, it's like, you don't want to let go in a sense.
Yeah.
I was talking with someone recently who keeps a very simple atmosphere, you know, no clutter, no junk anywhere. And he was saying, you know, with everything, you know, I just say, do I use it or don't I use it? And, you know, if it hasn't been used in a year, you know, it goes. And it's, you know, and sometimes, I mean, I think sometimes we try to be frugal and we want to think, well, do we need it? But still, it's that letting go sometimes too, that can be hard. Cause it's like, you're like, oh gosh, I have this. I don't want to let it go. And I have noticed too, all those storage units, and I've been tempted to want to get a storage unit sometimes. And I'm like, just forget it. Nope.
And I think it's when you get to be a certain age, I think, Michelle, as you were saying, you actually maybe inherit possessions from your parents or relatives, and you may not need them, but there's something about them that feels like a piece of that person. And that whole process makes you acquire more things that you didn't really have before. And it's a new challenge. And if those people were born in the Depression era, they had a certain way of keeping things that you valued because you needed something. You just went to that. They were the local Sam's, really. They were your Costco. But what do you do with all of it? And then, you know, like as we were with my parents, the moment we got rid of something, of course, one of us would need it. You're like, ugh. And so it was just those hard things. And it's just one of those hard things. And so I was just fascinated with that portion. I'm going to spend more time with that from Father Dave's reflection on how does that pursuit of passion get in the way of pursuit of Jesus? How does it get in pursuit, and how do those things get us sidetracked? And I think I shared this in the Wednesday group. You know, I had this obsession with a backsplash, and only to realize that I really didn't need a backsplash. All I needed was paint. And but it was just because I thought everybody had backsplash, and you watch HGTV and everybody has a fancy backsplash. But all I really needed was a paint and a paintbrush. But it was one of those things that there was this awareness. And it was really funny, like in my story, I went and bought all of these samples. Like I had, 18 samples. I'm like, well, what do I need the samples for? So it was just, it was an interesting letting go process for me to realize what is really essential and what is just, I don't want to say a brainwashing, but the product of watching too many things that tell me I need these things. Mm-hmm. I was sharing a little earlier today is that like with the wedding industry, we, before mm-hmm. Princess Diana, we had family style weddings where the parents and the grandparents and the aunts and uncles made all the food. They may have had a caterer, but everybody contributed to the celebration, and it was a family affair. After Diana, it became a sense of businesses, and we began to have, planners, wedding planners, and we had different things with it where we transferred a sacramental celebration into a business. And mm-hmm. and I've joked about this for years, the day after, and even sometimes sooner, depending on what the Christmas market looks like, first communion dresses are put out December 26th. And then everybody thinks they need to rush and buy these dresses. And some of their price tags are astronomical for something that they're really well, maybe wear 4 hours, maybe. And you'll have grandmas and aunts and uncles saying that they, they're going to buy the $500 dress rather than the passed down dresses. So we see how a capitalism kind of puts our lens and changes, our passions.
Is that what Father Dave was talking about when he said that the structures and the powers and the systems of the world? Mm-hmm. That's what I thought. Yeah.
Yeah. It's exactly what he was talking about. So I think it's something for us to all to be mindful of. Amy, do you want to add anything in there?
No, one thing he did mention really quickly, and I didn't even catch it the first time, is he mentioned the book, The Screwtape Letters, which is the book by C.S. Lewis. And I see a lot of you shaking your heads. Have a lot of you read it? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I haven't read the whole thing cover to cover, but he did mention that. And he met basically this book. It's brilliant, written by C.S. Lewis. And it's a conversation between two demons, essentially, as to how they are going to destroy, like ruin people's lives, and the ways that they look at each person, each individual, and determine like ways, inroads in, and depending on where they are, if they're further along, they have to like up their game. And and the book really does create it paints a very clear reality. It paints a very clear reality of the way that the devil can work and try to tempt us and try to distract us or give us a focus apart from God, or even completely derail us or completely make us turn our backs on him. And it's interesting because like with some of the saints, they battled Satan, like physically battled Satan. And like Padre Pio would say, bring me my weapon, bring me my weapon. And he meant his rosary, but they physically battled Satan. And it's almost like the devil will find, based on, our circumstances, whatever inroads they can to kind of to keep us away from God. And in the case of some of the saints, there's just nothing that they've been able to do to keep these people away from God. So it's like, it's almost like the last ditch effort because of pure frustration and anger that they can't can't turn that soul away from God. So it kind of gives you a perspective of like, when you encounter things or are dealing with something, it's like, okay, how is this being used in a sense to keep me away from God, to as a block, as a barrier to my relationship with Jesus? So it does that book, if you ever get a chance, and it's only about that thick. It's a nice, interesting read too. Is anybody read? I saw some of you shaking your heads. What is your take on it?
It was required reading back in the day when you went to a liberal arts college.
Oh.
Yeah, there's a lot to be said. I mentioned at the top of the video that I have a really brief reflection that just dovetails what you just said, Amy. And it's from the scripture, and it's going to be Jesus' response to Peter. When the first time how you hear something, but you don't really hear it. The first time I really heard this, I was unsettled by the line from that point on to now. So I'm going to play this. I'm not going to play the whole thing. I'm going to play a brief part of it. But it's important to understand that we are like Peter in what Jesus is saying. I'm not getting sound, am I?
With him.
There it goes. Now you have it.
He said, I have greatly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. I tell you, I will not eat again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God.
So that line, Satan has asked for your hand and has sifted you all like wheat. How does that hit you?
Hard. I never really heard it like that spoken. Satan has, what was it? Satan has asked for your hand and has sifted
you. And he will sift each of you like wheat as he tries to kind of, you know, like wow. Picture a sifter. And, but the fact that, I can't hear it without getting goosebumps. Satan has asked for our hand. And that's kind of what Dave was saying in the video about how we have to take it seriously. We have to kind of, recognize that he's like a hungry lion, just looking for that moment of entry. And then, but we have to be mindful of what Father Dave said and what Sister said, the power, we have the power. But that asking for our hand can be unsettling, because the Satan will look for those opportunities, as Amy was saying, that, or the evil one will look for opportunities where you're most vulnerable. It could be a time when you're very tired. It could be a time when there just seems to be chaos all around you and you can't see your way clear. I have found that there are events that will happen, a series of what I call lemony snicket unfortunate events. And many of you know that there was a bunch of things happening and we ended up having town meetings. I broke my ankle on the first day of faith formation. 3 weeks later, I broke my toe on the same foot of the ankle that I broke. So I'm in the boot again. I mean, I'm just never getting out of this boot. And then I get pneumonia. And then we have COVID. It was this series of unfortunate events. So I was convinced, I'm to this day convinced that we are on the cusp of something great, because he was going after each of us with different things, trying to detract us and to, you know, but I kept saying, I have the power of God within me, go away. So it was just, but the day that my toe broke on my broken ankle, I can't tell you that day. I sat rocking going, please God, no God, no God. Cause my toe hurt so bad. And it was just this ankle was such a, but I was so grateful it was my left foot, not my right foot, but it was such an impediment to my work. It was an impediment. Anybody have anything to share from that? Like, you know, have you ever been in a situation where you know you're doing something right, but something keeps going wrong, like a series of lemony snicket events? Anybody who's read Lemony Snicket knows what I mean. It's all these unfortunate things.
Well, Lorraine and Joe and Sally and I have all been involved in the Curcio movement. And we've been involved in putting on the weekends and speaking at these weekends and giving talks. And it always seems, no matter what your job is on the weekend, something's going to go wrong. And it happens over and over again. You've given your talk, you've practiced it, you have a song you want to play, you go to play that song, and you know that it's in the right place, you've checked it a million times, and when you press that button, it doesn't. So we feel that the devil is there trying his best, you know, to trip you up, to keep you from bringing people to Jesus. But I have another thing, and I don't know how anybody thinks about this, but the COVID virus itself has kept many churches closed, many people from going to church. We're not receiving the Eucharist, and we don't really know the cause, or we don't know the truth behind how this is all happening. But I feel it's giving the devil many opportunities. How many people will come back to church, you know?
Mm-hmm. Jean, I agree with you. I think I said that in one of our first meetings. I said, I feel like this is a battle time. Yeah. I, I just sense it. I feel it. I feel like there's a major battle going on, and I can feel the bad, but I'm clinging on to what he said about in those moments of bad, you know, something good is going to happen. And it almost tells you you're heading the right way. Cause it's like, oh, it's getting a little, it's like when you're getting closer to the line, you know. I guess I've never been a veteran, but when they talk about, my dad tells me, you knew you were getting closer to the front because the noise would get loud. And sometimes I think the closer we are to a victory or to getting to where we need to go, it's scary. And
I think it's so interesting you brought that up, because the whole time I was watching the John Michael Talbot, all I could concentrate on was the fact that watching the people receive the Eucharist and then the blood of Christ, and thinking, because of this COVID, we might not receive the blood of Christ, who knows, ever again, who knows. It might be, it's going to be a long time. And I thought then, well, we're talking about the evil one. That's all I could think about, was watching those people and thinking, when will that happen?
I know people who have, in this past year, come closer to Christ.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. Has anybody gone the other way?
Yeah, who have gone away. And I've watched people that I know, you know, people that we're talking about watching a certain mass on YouTube, and, oh, wasn't that homily amazing? And there's a discussion going on that never happened before. So
I told Amy this earlier in the day, and I think it's too soon to tell in terms of everything, but remember that line from Paul when he wrote, death, where's your victory? Where's your sting? That, what may look like burnt ashes, what may look like things falling down, God has a way of working, and his power and his, and making beautiful things make, you know, the, just spring out of that. I actually am holding on to that. And maybe, you know, you can call it naivety, but I just don't think it's over. I feel like God is going to, make some beautiful things. I mean, there have been some interesting things that have happened in terms of, as you said, people have had discussions about God. Some people have come to a better understanding what family truly means, because they couldn't be with their family. And so their family, rather than being annoyed by their family, they became valuing those sacred moments. So I there's so many mysteries, as Jean is putting on, you know, what Jean said about all of this, but I, in my sense, my hope is in the Lord. My hope is going to be that how he unpacks all this is going to be the greatest victory of all. Just like
thy will be done on earth. I just keep hearing that over and over and over again. That's the ultimate goal, isn't it? That this place becomes the kingdom. God's kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, God's thank kingdom. You. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're reading a really good book now for centering prayer.
What's that?
Abandonment to Divine Providence. And it's by D. Cassatt. And he is so powerful. And the thing that he keeps saying throughout it, we're on the last chapter six, there are only five chapters, but the six chapters can take you 6 years to read it because it's that deep. But what he was saying today in the chapter was, remember one thing, God is inside you, he's with you, he loves you, no matter what you're going through, and you will go through hard times. God will see you through it because he loves you. And I thought, ooh, I'm going to write that one down. Keep it in mind. Because that was so
kind of goes what Maine was saying. That's where the point where, you know, the scriptures tell us Satan has asked for our hand. So those are those hard times. And then as Jean was saying, we don't, you know, there's this whole chaos with COVID and nobody knows where it's coming from. And there's all this suspicion and we don't know what's going on. And SARS has been around, but has it been this bad? We have all this unanswered. But if we can keep our eyes on what you just said, Sally, if we keep our eyes on that power, that God will be triumphant in it. That's the hope we have to hold, you know, we're holding on to. I have so much more, but believe it or not, it's almost time. I am going to close with a song that speaks to the power. Just as a reminder that I hope you can take these lyrics in. And the next week ahead, just kind of say the lyrics over and over to yourself, reminding you of that. So I'm going to share again. And hold on. Where did it go? Here we go. There we go. Da, da, da. Hold on. I get teary with this song, so if I start to cry, just ignore me.
I can see what is raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. I can face every fear of the unknown. I can hear God's children singing out. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commanded death to wait, lives in us, lives in us. The same power mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us. We have hope that his promises are true. In his strength there is nothing we can't do. Yes, we know there are greater things in store. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks.
That same power lives in each one of us. And I hope you can go home with your home. Why would I say go home? I can take that strength of that song and be reminded that that is with each one of us at this moment, in this time, and in this place. So, amen. That was
amen. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, man.
So, believe it or not, we only have two more to go, but I'm going to ask you to consider coming back for the third one, because Joe and Sally are going to share some pictures from the Holy Land with us. And so I thought that might be kind of fun, like kind of as our farewell, because, you know, but so just kind of plan if you can. And Jean, I want to thank you. I did not know you were a part of the Corsia movement. So I had a good friend who was definitely very active in the Corsia. So we might, I might try pulling that back in a little, in the next episode, the next Zoom. So any final parting words, Miss A?
No, no. Nope.
Father Dave doesn't talk about the Holy Land in this Metanoia series. But the background of all the places where he's talking is in the Holy Land. And back in 2000, Sally and I made a trip with Franciscan University with Father Dave and Father Scanlon and some other priests over to the Holy Land. And so I thought it might be informative to share those pictures with you as to where the places were that he's been showing us in the background as he speaks with us each time.
I'm ready to go. Yeah. I want you to lead us. I want this group to be on a road trip. That's what I want.
And then having been doing like some of the other St. Joseph things, I think really seeing these places in the Holy Land are really important to our own faith journey. And I wanted to kind of lead with that note. Angela had alluded to it earlier, that some of the readings that those of us have been doing, the consecration, and some of you have done it before, or may we'll do it again or do it in the future. It's so important to know that we have the Blessed Mother, but we also have Joseph, who's the terror of the terrorizer. And so we have to kind of be mindful of how he took care of Jesus to get him out of you know, the evil that was working through Herod at the time. So it's important for us to kind of see we have I don't know if you want to call it just a history of in this communion of saints who are all there rooting for us. We have this entire 2,000 years worth of faith-filled people, people like Padre Pio, who just are fighting for us too. So when we feel that we're being overcome, we have to remember we have the power of Jesus and we have the power of our network behind us too.
Right.
So amen.
Amen. And just as you mentioned St. Joseph, just one thing is May 1st, some of you have been doing the consecration to St. Joseph, but if you haven't, there is a virtual event that is, I don't know actually where they're doing it from, but it's a virtual event on St. Joseph, and it's on St. Joseph the Worker. And it's from 9 to 11 on May 1st, and it's Scott Hahn and Father Boniface Hicks and Mike Aquilina. And it's a, you know, 2-hour virtual talk, live virtual talk, all three of them. And we're going to have that be our focus for this consecration to St. Joseph. And then we'll do the prayers right afterwards. But just so you're aware of that, so you can put that on your calendars, 9 to 11 on May 1st, Saturday, May 1st.
All right. Yeah, so yes. We got lots going on.
Mm-hmm. We do.
It was great seeing all of you who joined us for First Communion Mass. Warning, in case you want to know, First Communion of Thomas a Becket is on Sunday morning this time at 9 a.m., not the Saturday night one. So it's reversed this week, okay? So
okay.
So it will be at 9 a.m. on this coming, and then it's Holy Spirit this Saturday. Mm-hmm. All right. All right, blessings, awesome. Everyone. Good night.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Good night.
Bye. Bye.